ngā kaihautu i ngā waka maha huri noi te motu tēnā koutou katoa. Nau mai hara mai kia tapatahi. Tēnei pai kōrero e wānanga nei ngā take nui o te wā. Welcome to Tapatahi. Thanks for joining us. Coming up on the program, Porirua GP Dr. Sarah Shasha is back to answer your questions. We talk with Employment and Associate Māori Development Minister Willie Jackson. What is the likely impact of COVID-19 on Māori workers? The chair of the Climate Change Iwi Leaders Group, Mike Smith, joins us. What does COVID-19 mean for climate change? Psychologist Talia Kingi offers advice on how to deal with lockdown in level 3. And as always, we have another wonderful whānau waiata. But first, here's what you need to know in 30 seconds. Ko te rā rua te kau mā iwa tēnei i roto i te rāhui. It's day 29 in lockdown. There are 6 new cases and all 6 are confirmed. 1,036 have recovered, which takes our new total of cases to 1,451. 124 are confirmed as Māori and 67 as Pacifica. 11 are in hospital, including 2 in ICU. There is no one in critical condition. 94,797 have been tested. Well, from Wednesday next week, schools and early childhood centres will reopen for those tamariki up to year 10 that can't learn from home or whose parents are returning to work. Joining us now is Porirua-based GP Dr. Sarah Shasha to answer your questions about the health and safety of your tamariki and some of your other burning questions. Tēnā koe, Sarah.
Tata mārie e Shane.
Tuatahi e mihi ana ki a koe mo te aitua kua tau ki tō kāinga o Pio Pio. I just want to acknowledge the passing of one of your whanaunga at Pio Pio and invite you to say a few words of poroporo aki.
Oh, tēnā koe e hoa. He mihi aroha ki a koutou katoa e te whānau Huia, te whānau James, ki a koe hoki Colleen, me o Kōrua Tamariki, he mihi aroha ki a koutou. I just wanted to send all my love back to you in Pio Pio, te rohe pōtai, te rohe o Maniapoto. It was a hard day yesterday for everybody, seeing us, all of us from around the world, around the motu, who couldn't come and do a haka with you on the streets of Pio Pio. So just sending you all our love, and moi mai rā e Paddy James. Kia ora, Shane.
Sarah, before we move on to these questions, I do want to ask, obviously a tragic experience for you and the wider whānau, but how was it not being able to be in Pio Pio to, as you normally would?
Yeah, dare I say it, COVID-19 and the lockdown has stripped us of our tikanga as Māori. And there have been so many of our whānau Māori lost during this time, and the inability to be at home, to awhi the whānau, to just be there and be present, as we all want to be connected at this really sad time, is so hard. And when you go onto Facebook and you see all the messages of aroha from all around the world, from all around the country to the whānau at home, just it's really heartbreaking, I suppose. So, yeah, that's them. I just really wanted to mihi to them today, because Jenny Mae Clarkson as well, being from Pio Pio, grew up with Paddy as well. So, yeah, it's hard, but it's what we have to do to stay safe, and I'm hoping that as time moves on, we can lift these restrictions and get together again and celebrate the people we've lost.
Well, again, our sympathy and condolences to you and the whānau and our sincere aroha. Let's move on, because we've got a few questions we need to get through this morning. The first one, of course, parents are having to make a decision about whether or not they send their kids back to kura or ECE. Should they be worried about their health and safety?
I think it's really important to acknowledge the anxiety for all, not only the tamariki, not only the parents, but also the teachers who are having to do this as well. But it's really important to note that there has been lots of thought put into this in terms of the safe return of tamariki to kura, to to schools, and you will have heard from your teachers by now what the plan is for your school. And obviously safety is number one, so the importance of staying at home if your tamariki is sick, same for the teachers. The importance of hygiene, of course, so that will be ensured. Surfaces will be cleaned regularly. And whānau, for our particular school, Discovery School here in Purirua, they're moving in bubbles of 10 and having family members within the bubbles, staggering breaks. And I guess the stink thing for the tamariki is that they won't be able to go and play on the playgrounds outside, and it is important that there's the 2 metre distancing outside as well, which will be difficult. I mean, let's be honest, it's going to be difficult for our kids. But we do have to think about our kaiako in all of this, because they're the ones that are who have to be there with the tamariki.
It is going to be really difficult when we think about the physical contact, right, that exists in our kura, how hard it's going to be to try and restrict that content between tamariki.
Absolutely. And, you know, if there's going to be one kaiako for 10, and I don't expect them to be following them around the school to see what they're doing outside, but I guess that's the importance of us at home parents, is to be making sure that we're educating our tamariki about the importance of safety, the distancing, the hygiene as much as you can. I know it's harder for our younger tamariki, but we can only but try whānau.
Absolutely. Well, let's move out of the school ground and think about in our homes and at our workplaces. Should we be relaxing hygiene standards because we're going into level 3?
Best answer to that is calm. You know, lockdown has taught us the importance of hygiene. So it's important that we continue to be hygienic, I suppose, in our workplaces. Wiping down our surfaces that we're at a lot, making sure you're washing your hands. Instead of happy birthday, we can use tū tira mai and tell our tamariki too. If you do that, sing that quickly, you've got the 20 seconds you need. So no, I don't think we relax too much, particularly at alert 3. As we move to 2 and 1, I guess things can change in that sense, but that still shouldn't stop us washing our hands, cleaning our surfaces hygienically, both at mahi and at home.
We have another question that's come in, and we have discussed this subject before about seeking medical advice, attention or support. Because we're moving to level 3, does that advice change in terms of reaching out if you are feeling sick?
Number one, whānau, if you're māwiwi, if you need support, your doctors and nurses are still there. So make sure you ring if you can. And if you don't have a phone, karangatū ki tō neighbour, ask them for their phone to ring a doctor for you. In alert level 3, we still aren't doing the face-to-face consultations for just the normal things, so like repeat medicines. But if you're really unwell, we still are doing the face-to-face consultations. Once we move to alert level 2, then health services will be moving back to working as normally as possible. So the face-to-face kānohi ki te kānohi will happen again, and it's important to ring your medical centre and just find out from them what they're doing, because everywhere will be a little bit different.
Can you just tell us what level 3 means for you, literally, in terms of that kānohi ki te kānohi interaction with those that are sick? Are they still presenting themselves to you in person, or is that changing?
To tell you the truth, we haven't had the number of whānau coming to the door for an acute assessment that we would normally expect, I guess, at this time of year. So everyone has really heard the messages about staying at home and ringing in. But, you know, there are a number of stories across the motu now from different doctors, ED, GP, where our whānau aren't presenting early enough, okay? So don't be having chest pain at home and not ringing anyone because you think because Jacinda said stay home. Carl, you need to ring us. We are still available and we want to look after you as much as we did in any other time of the year.
Our favourite Purirua GP, Dr. Sarah Shasha, thank you again for your time. Thank you for joining us. We do really appreciate it. Tēnā rā tū koe.
Me koe hoki. Kahi te whānau.
COVID-19 related job losses are set to rise, and there are fears Māori unemployment could reach as high as 20%. Nationally, and up to 35% in some regions. Treasury forecasts predict a best-case scenario of overall unemployment rising to just under 10%. But even before COVID-19, Māori unemployment was just over 8%, double the overall rate of 4%. With me now is Willie Jackson, the Employment Minister and Associate Minister of Māori Development, to discuss what he is doing to help Māori in terms of jobs. Tēnā koe, Willie. Thanks for joining us.
Here we go.
Kia ora. Kia ora, Willie.
Can you hear me? I can hear you and the laptop died on us just before we came. Can you see me at all, Shane, or no?
We can't see you at the moment, Willie, but we can hear you crystal clear.
Okay. All right. I will be 1 second. All right. You can see me now. No?
We're just checking. Yep, we can see. We've got a picture.
You're up on
screen now.
And Jenny.
A little bit lopsided, okay. But we can...
We'll get there, and there we go. Kia ora.
Kia ora, Willie. Well, thank you again. Thank you again for joining us this morning. We're talking about, obviously, your portfolio area and what COVID-19 is going to do, or what the impact is for Māori employment. What advice have you received about the impact of COVID-19 on Māori workers?
The advice is that... There are huge impacts, Shane, and in terms of the general population, you would have heard some of the kōrero with regards to the unemployment. You would have heard the Treasury scenarios that it could blow out, Shane, to 20-25% if there was no support, no targeted funding. So, you know, if the general trend is 20-25%, you can imagine what Māori unemployment would blow out to. My view is we can't let that happen. That's the same as Minister Grant Robinson. We say that we have to get in there and provide support. And we've done that, Shane, particularly in the last couple of weeks in terms of the wage subsidies that have gone out. And as you would know, 1.5 million New Zealanders have been supported with the wage subsidies. And thousands and thousands of Māori have benefited off that. And so we know that for a fact. And I'm pleased, you know, because it's been open to NGOs. It's not just to the big industries or anything like that. So I know people close to me and businesses, who Māori businesses, have all got in there so that their workers would get support. So, you know, there's been thousands of Māori who've benefited off the wage subsidies. And then, of course, we've got the increase in terms of benefit payments, $25 a week, the winter payments coming up. So a lot of assistance given to New Zealanders and to Māori. And then, of course, as separate to that, we have our own, buy Māori, for Māori packages, Shane. So, you know, a lot of impacts in terms of Māori, but we have to be nimble enough to roll with that and work with our people, which is what we're doing right now in terms of developing strategies going forward in terms of the budget, in terms of what we can do with our people.
And many of the people that we've had on this program, Willie, have been very appreciative and have recognised and acknowledged the support that the government is providing workers and businesses at the moment, without a doubt, absolutely. The question, however, that they have is, what else can they expect? What more support can they expect from government? And let me put that question to you. What are you currently working on? You've mentioned the budget, which we'll see in a few weeks' time, but what are you currently working on in addition to what's already been announced?
I'm currently working on with the Māori ministers, I suppose, a Māori response package, Shane. Myself, Minister Mahuta, Minister Davis and Minister Henare, we're working on our Māori response package, where we know employment has to be a huge part of that. We have to support our people. I don't want the Māori unemployment rate blowing out to 20-30%. When I came in, Shane, it was just under 11%. We got it down to 8%. And so, you know, we're nervous about where it's going to blow out to. So we as a group of ministers are working on a Māori response package right now. Included in that, of course, are programs that I've already been working on, like Mana and Mahi, Shane, where we're helping young people in terms of apprenticeships. He Pautama Rangatahi, where we're working with... where we're working in the regions and working with communities in terms of uplifting young people. You recall your relation, Shane Jones, saying, kick the nefs off the couch. You know, we'll all remember that kōrero. That was the driver in terms of He Pautama Rangatahi. What we have to do is we have to invest more in those programs. Mana and Mahi is good too, because we're working with business people and they've really taken a bit of a hit. So we have to get into those programs. We have to get into our cadetships, Shane, and resource them more and ramp it up. So that's what I'm working on right now. I've got, you know, our days are made up of meeting of Zoom calls and meeting with our officials. I'm meeting with TPK today in terms of how we can address Māori concerns coming up, particularly in the employment area. But, you know, we have the programs that have been successful already, Shane. Mm. And I think if we wrap them up, resource them more, we might be able to cushion the blow going forward. But this is such a... Shane, this is such a opportunistic time, perhaps, for our people. Time for entrepreneurs to step up. Maybe time for iwi to step up. I know that, and I heard you saying Mike was coming on later, Mike Smith, who has a weekly call with us, with Calvin Davis. I haven't been able to join those because I've been in other meetings, but Mike and Debbie Pack are very fruitful kōrero happening with us. And what I've said is that this might be a time for iwi to maybe pursue partnerships, to maybe use some of the money that they've talked about. I mean, you know and I know they talk about a $50 billion Māori business economy. Maybe an opportunity here to partner up with us in a few ventures. And I know Ngāi Tahu are talking with us right now, and I'd like to see other iwi come to the table.
Ka pai, Willie. And I've avoided interrupting you because, you know, very important kōrero. Do you mind just tipping your phone slightly just so we can see your full face? The other way, okay. If you can. Yeah, there we go. Ka pai. Look, I do want to go back to your... back to where you had it before, if you can. We're seeing a bit more of your light shade than anything else, and we don't want that to be seen.
Oh, okay.
Ka pai, Willie. No, that looks great. I just want to go back to your kōrero around the response package, and it appears that you're working on beefing up what is currently in place. Are you looking at anything specifically new in light of COVID-19, are you working on anything new that's going to specifically help Māori businesses, Māori workers?
Well, what we've already got, and we're looking at I can't give a lot of some details, but we're looking at a special, hopefully we want to get special packages through where Māori businesses can apply for support, Shane. So I can't give a lot of details on that, but that's a... I spoke with Minister Robertson last week. So, yes, we've got He Pautama Rangatahi. Yes, we've got Mana and Mahi. Yes, we're giving wage subsidies out. On top of that, and we've got our cadetships going, but we're also looking at a special pūtea that'll be made available, particularly for our entrepreneurs, our people who know how to rev and set up our people, Shane. And there's going to be opportunities there. So we've got Māori ministers. We're saying, well, what can we do in terms of pulling our people forward? Because we don't want this unemployment rate to blow out. Is it going to be worse? Of course, it's going to be worse. It's going to hit double figures and all that. But the more assistance and more support we can give, I think we'll cushion the blow for our people.
Can I just ask you finally, because we are out of time, there have been calls from the National Party, or criticism of the checkpoints that we've seen set up around the country. And I'm interested to know your view on checkpoints and whether or not you support that call or you oppose that call.
I don't support the National Party's view, Shane. I salute a lot of the work done by our people in the regions. You'll find, and what I've having followed this and talked with some of our Māori police. What I like is that they have been working in tandem with the police, and you'll find in general that those roadblocks or whatever they're called are helpful, not just for Māori, but for Pākehā. I mean, Shane, it's not often Hone Harawira gets the support of Pākehā community too in the north, and he's got quite a lot of support there. So, you know, as long as they obey the rules and they work in an ethical manner, which has been very much the case that I've heard, I'm supportive of it. Long as they continually liaise with our local police, I don't personally see a big problem with it. And so the Nats are saying one thing, but in general, I think our people are doing pretty well out there.
Thank you, Willie Jackson, for joining us, the Employment Minister. Thank you again for your time.
Kia ora, Shane.
Willie Jackson, the Employment Minister and Associate Māori Development Minister too. Well, there are fears New Zealand will turn its back on climate change and the environment in the rush to get back to business quickly after COVID-19 eases. Chairperson of the Climate Change Iwi Leaders Group, Mike Smith, warns that the old economy took us to the brink of human destruction through climate chaos. He says now is our chance to reverse that and build a new economy that will be good for business and good for the planet. Mike Smith is also the lead of the National Iwi Chairs Forum Pandemic Response Group, and he's with me now. Tēnā koe, Mike.
Tēnā koe, Shane. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you too. If we go back to business as usual after COVID-19, what will be the effects on the environment and climate change?
Well, if we go back to business as usual, Shane, we'll witness a catastrophic climate disaster that'll make the COVID-19 pandemic look like a picnic. Widespread global droughts, floods, storms, famine, economic collapse, heat waves, displacing and killing millions of people. That's what the orthodox science is telling us. That's not fear-mongering. That's what the consensus is amongst the world's politicians, witnessed by the annual assemblies of world leaders to confront this problem, and the scientific community. So it's a very, very serious problem. So we can't go back to business as usual.
Shovel-ready construction projects such as roads and infrastructure is being rolled out from Tuesday. What do you think about that in light of what you've just shared with us?
Well, our economy was already broken as far as many Māori are concerned. And, you know, an economy that doesn't deliver for a significant section of its population, namely Māori and other poor people in our communities, is a broken economy. It's not working. And so as far as many Māori are concerned, that if we miss the opportunity to reset our broken economy and in the process lock ourselves into debt that our tamariki will have to pay over the next decades, particularly for projects that are backward-looking instead of forward-looking, is not the approach that we want to see. It's a dollars-for-dinosaurs approach, and that's a mistake.
So new roads, new infrastructure, doesn't that mean more jobs for Māori unemployed, Māori that we've just spoken about with the Minister? Isn't that a good thing?
Yeah, well, the thing is that the infrastructure in this country didn't fall down, unlike disasters like Christchurch and Kaikoura, where you had to go and build the infrastructure back up. Nothing's actually fallen down. So what's happened is people have just stopped spending, and that's where the problem is. So, for example, we go and invest a whole lot of public money in a port somewhere. That might do well for the people of that region, but we need to spread. We need to look at the equity spread right across the country. You know, how are people in Ngāi Tūhoe, for example, going to benefit from some mega project on the other side of the country? So I think we've just got to take an even and balanced approach, and we've got to look for, for forward-looking economic solutions rather than investing in the old bricks and mortar.
Well, what does that look like in your view? How should we approach the return to so-called normal?
Well, in my view, we've got to approach the return to normal with extreme caution. We must not repeat the mistakes that we've seen around the world, where countries have beaten back the first wave of the COVID-19, only to be crushed by the second wave. So my advice to people would be, you know, kia au ki te kaupapa, kia mau ki tō whare, and don't go wandering out hugging everybody when the levels come down. the pandemic has leveled off, but it hasn't gone away, and it's not going to go away until we find a vaccine. And so we're not quite there yet, so we've just got to stick with the program.
There are real and pressing concerns for Māori, such as looming high unemployment, food security, housing security, and so on. Where does climate change fit into all of this? What's more important?
Well, I think we've got to reset our priorities as a nation and rebuild the type of society in which there's equity across the landscape. You know, we can't go back to... and what that means is homes for everybody and meaningful employment for everybody, an end to the obscenity of a minority of people condensing wealth into smaller and smaller elites, while the burgeoning levels of poverty and homelessness that we've seen on the streets in our city comes to an end. One of the really one of the positive things I've seen happen during this outbreak has been all of a sudden the homeless are in homes, and there's people who have previously been hungry and children, you know, who didn't have lunches. You've covered those stories in the past. All of a sudden they're getting food support in a way that they weren't getting before. Now, why wasn't that happening 5 months ago? Why is it taking a crisis like this to find those solutions? So I'm fully anticipating that what we've got to do is change the gears, and we've just got to lock in those types of supports for people going forward into the future.
I want to raise something that Willie Jackson mentioned in our earlier interview, and I'm not sure if you heard that. But, and I'm paraphrasing here, but it's almost he set a challenge to iwi to be stepping up during this time, to be investing, be setting up partnership opportunities to create employment, to create, to support iwi and hapu and whānau. And I get that you're not here representing the iwi leaders forum in that regard, but do you have a view on that?
Yes, what I've seen is the speed and the scale of the iwi response to the pandemic has been phenomenal. You know, and has the response in the urban areas by Māori NGOs like the one that Willie, John Tamahere and others, you know, urban-based community groups, you know, has really been phenomenal. And it just shows how nimble we are when it comes to issues like this, and that deep, abiding sense of... commitment that we have to each other, you know, and that whanaungatanga. I think we do have a major role to play. You know, as previously mentioned, Māori control a ever-increasing slice of the economy, and we're not going away. We're here for the long haul. This is our home. We have nowhere else to go, so we've got a long-term investment in getting things right here. So, yes, I think more iwi crown partnerships in terms of finding solutions we can work together on is the way to go.
Mike Smith, thank you very much for your time this morning. Thank you for joining us. E mihi atu ana ki a koe.
Ai me koe hoki. Tarangatira, tēnā koe.
Well, looking after our mental health well-being is essential right now. Calls to the National Mental Health Line have jumped 40%, indicating it's a very tense time for some of us. COVID-19 is rapidly changing the way we work, socialise, travel, access healthcare, exercise, shop and live. Many whānau are feeling anxious, stressed and worried. To discuss how whānau can manage their mental health and well-being during these uncertain times, Dr. Talia Kingi, who is a clinical psychologist, joins me now. Tēnā koe.
Tēnā koe.
Thank you again for joining us. What tips or advice can you offer to whānau to help manage their mental health and well-being during these pretty uncertain times?
Yeah, I think, first off, I think it's really important to say that, acknowledge, I guess, how hard this is for whānau. I think Monday's announcement about going into Alert Level 3 provided some hope. You know, there's a light at the end of the tunnel, that these sacrifices that we have made so far are working. The struggle hasn't been for nothing, but we're not there yet. And there is still a lot of anxiety and uncertainty about the future for all of us, and that increases as time goes on. So I think it's important to say that whatever you're feeling right now, whānau, it's okay. You know, if you find yourself feeling irritable, angry, frustrated, these are all normal reactions to a very abnormal, scary situation that we're all going through. So my advice is to take this time to settle and to connect with yourself. Do whatever you need to do to settle your Māori, to be Māorito, you know. And we can start by recognising what state our Māori is in at the moment. Is it tau? Is it Māori oho? Are we feeling really anxious or on guard? Are we having these really intense emotional experiences and being really reactive in our responses? So once you can recognise where you are at, then you can do what you can to bring yourself back into being in a state of Māorito, if that's where you need to be within your pātū waka waka. So recognising what karearoto or emotions we're experiencing right now, and then having strategies in place to bring your Māori back in balance with your context.
What strikes me is that as we prepare to move from level 4 to level 3, you would have expected that anxiety or angst levels would be going down, but for some whānau, they're actually going up in terms of preparing for their tamariki to return to school or even themselves returning to mahi. What advice do you have for them?
Yeah, so I think it's really important that we're all looking after our own well-being so that we can be well enough to support those around us. You know, a lot of our Māori whānau shy away from looking after ourselves and practising that self-care because it's been seen as selfish or individualistic, like a non-Māori way of doing things, I guess. However, we need to be strong ourselves in order for our whānau to lean on us, to depend on us, for us to fill all of those roles that we need to fill. So if you're that pō that's holding your whare up, and if the foundations of your pō are not strong, then the whole whare is compromised, which is why it is really important to strengthen your foundations and do this in whatever ways work for you. So coming back to that kōrero around Māori, finding ways to settle into whatever state you need to be in, and also be kind to yourself. I think we need to ease up on some of the expectations that we're placing on ourselves. If you're doing the best that you can, then that is enough and you are enough. You know, if we're not teachers, or some of us are not teachers, and so if homeschooling isn't working, I think just spending time connecting and teaching your tamariki in other ways, you know, he kura te kāinga, he kāinga te kura. So, yeah, looking after yourself is really important at any time, but as the stress increases and there's that uncertainty, it becomes even more important.
Where can whānau go to access mental health and wellbeing services if they need immediate support?
Yeah, so I think it's important to know that mental health and addiction services are essential services that are still available during lockdown. Now, I know that a lot of our whānau don't access these services because of bad experiences themselves or within their whānau or through the kumara vine, you know, which put them off. So it's important for whānau to remember that when it comes to accessing these services, we have rights such as to be treated with respect and dignity, to be listened to and understood. And there are things that we can do to make sure that we are safe, such as keeping records of our contacts and our kōrero and taking support people with us. So we need to start breaking down some of these barriers to our people getting the support that they need. So please, whānau, use the services that are available in your community. But the other important thing to remember is that in Te Ao Māori, our knowledge comes in many forms, and while our traditional knowledge might not be scientifically validated in a Western sense, it's been passed on through generations. And so we as Māori are here, and we as a people have survived because of that knowledge. So it's not necessarily the doctors and those with lots of tohu in front and after their name, and I can say that because I am one of them, that we don't necessarily hold all that knowledge. So looking to our tohunga around karakia, and our mōteatea and our pūrākau, I think, because within those taonga tuku iho are the keys to wellbeing that resonate with who we are as Māori.
Do things change for you as we shift to level 3 and the way in which you offer your services and support to whānau?
Not really. Myself and our hoa mātai hiningaro, we've continued to operate remotely. So all of our sessions are held over Zoom or over the phone, which I think is important for our whānau to know that we're still here to support them during these difficult times. There were some challenges initially with helping some whānau to get adequate technology, you know, especially in our rural communities. So we've had to be creative about how we do that. But as soon as we knew we were going into alert level 4, and we had to think ahead and ensure that, you know, someone within each pātū waka waka had a phone so that I could call them on. So our current clients are mostly taken care of. However, the problem now that we're aware of is that whānau who have never accessed our services before but now want to don't have the capability to do that. And it's those basic needs. They don't have a home phone or internet or cell phone reception to make calls. Within Te Arawa, we've done our best to reach out to those who are on our registers and ensure that their basic needs have been met. But I think it highlights these bigger issues around access and the needs of our people. Mm. You know, these difficulties were in place long before COVID. And I think in Ngāti Whakaue, this pandemic has forced our hand as an iwi to step up and support our people.
Dr. Talia Kingi, I've really enjoyed listening to you this morning. Thank you for your words of wisdom and advice to our whānau watching today. Tēnā rā tū koe, ka nui te mihi.
Nā koe, Shane. Ka kite.
Food for thought. Bianca Tahere and her two daughters, 13-year-old Tui and 6-year-old Neve, are based in Ōtaki. Bianca used to be in a band, and when she would practice, Tui would mimic her. That's when she knew her daughter could sing. Earlier today, I spoke with Bianca, Tui and Neve. Bianca, Tui and Neve, tēnā koutou, nō mai, hara mai, welcome to the program. How are you all this morning?
Hi, tēnā koe matua, Shane.
Yeah.
How are you? Ka pai. How are you after 4 weeks in lockdown? How has lockdown been for you all?
Taking time.
Tui, what about you? How has lockdown been for you?
It's a bit hoha because you can't really see your friends. You can't really hang out with them. So, yeah.
Is that what you have missed the most? Not being able to see your friends? Be with your friends?
Me too. When they're like in Whanganui and you can't really visit them.
So. What about for Mum? How has lockdown been for you, Bianca?
It's been quite hard. Same for Tui, not being able to see my whānau. Definitely with our nana being in one of the rest homes in Paraparumu, so we haven't seen her in a very long time. So that's been really stressful for us. Missing my kids at kohanga? it's been quite hard. It's challenging.
So your mum's been in a rest home and you wouldn't have been able to visit her. Have you been able to stay in contact by phone or by online means?
Our nana. So it's my mum's mother. So our nana is in a rest home. We've been very fortunate enough to be able to ring her for very short periods. Mm. Yeah, we can't FaceTime her or anything, just the nurse aide will bring the phone to her and we can talk to her. Being able to see my parents, even though they're just down the road and Paraparumu can't even see them. But a lot of the time we've been FaceTiming all our whānau.
Pretty tough. And of course you're missing your kids at Kohanga Reo.
Missing my kids at Kohanga Reo, even though we're teaching online, so we see our kids every morning.
So how has that experience been, trying to stay connected with your tamariki, with the mokopuna at the Kohanga Reo?
Very challenging. It's a new experience. Trying to be very interactive with our tamariki. Normally your tamariki are in front of you, so teaching online to our tamariki and, it's definitely been a new challenge for me. Also, being able to see all our tamariki online, there's only like a few that you can see along the bottom of the screen and you can't tell if the other tamariki are there or not. Mm. You know, if they're in having fun and enjoying it. I know that our tamariki are missing us and we're missing them.
Tui, tell me about the community production that you were meant to sing at.
A bit sad that it got cancelled because of the COVID-19.
It was a cabaret. Yeah. It's a cabaret that she was going to perform in. Mm. Also, she had auditioned for Hairspray just before the COVID-19.
Well, hopefully when we're over and we're past COVID-19 and all this is put to rest, there'll be plenty more opportunity for you. Bianca, tell me about the award the girls won for R&B at the lockdown karaoke.
So it was my mum that entered them into this lockdown talent quest. And the two girls, they won the genre for R&B with the song that they're going to sing today, Mercy. So many people shared the post and liked, and there was just so many comments about the girls. That's why they got the award for R&B. And this has pretty much been Tui's way of being able to entertain, because she hasn't been able to perform in the cabaret one night only, you know, to do an audition for Hairspray. Also, her and her really good friend, James Kiriama Stent, were going to perform in Palmerston for the volleyball nationals just before we went into lockdown. And so this has been Tui's, you know, way of expressing herself, being able to perform, performing for the mutu pretty much, with the lockdown talent quest that she's, that her and her sister have both been doing.
Awesome. And of course, you're going to perform for the mutu this morning. You mentioned, Bianca, the song that's been chosen is Mercy. Can you tell us why this song choice, which is one of my personal favourites too, I have to say?
That's because I love Duffy. She's a cool singer. I like how she sings. And it's a really cool song.
It is a cool song. Well, the time is all yours. The stage is yours too. Kei a koutou te wa.
Kia ora.
Mautewehi, tēnā kōrua, Tui and Neve, tēnā kōrua, o tira koutou ko Bianca, e mihi nui atu ana mātou o whakaata Māori, kia kōrua, kia koutou, tēnā rau atu koutou.
Kia ora.
Ka kite.
Ka kite. kite matoshe.
Now, don't forget, whānau, we've launched a competition where you could win $1,000. All you need to do is create a 5-minute video that shows the motu what you're doing during lockdown, and of course it must be fun. We'll announce the winner this Monday. So go to our Māori Television Facebook page, like it, and DM your video through. It's that easy. Well, thank you to our guests that joined us today, and thank you for tuning in. Koe nā atapatahi mo tēnei rā, kia piki te ora te kaha, me te māramatanga kia koutou katoa. Hei kona, mō tēnei wā.